Hey, I know it's been a minute since I made anything. You know, I just thought, you know, with the occasion, I would pop back in and kind of talk about things a little bit, huh? Have a little fun. Don't worry, this is not a video about Zack Snyder, at least not him specifically. If you want to see somebody trying to figure out what makes that guy tick, there's a lot of other great videos out there. Specifically, I recommend you go check out Maggie Mae Fish's videos on the subject. You know, I've only been back for like 10 seconds, and I'm already telling you to go somewhere else. As far as my opinion goes on Zack Snyder and his films, I don't think they're very good. He's way more interested in style than he is substance, and all of his stories are a little bloated and too convoluted for no good reason at all. And then what stylistic choices he does make, they're usually a little too on the nose.
The comedian's dead.
Hello, darkness, my old friend.
He doesn't really handle female characters all that well, or any characters for that matter, and he's really into shoehorning Christian imagery where it doesn't belong. And he's pretty blatantly uncritical of the US military and its institutions. So, yeah, I don't think he's a bad guy personally, but that's not what this video is about. You see, what I'm interested in is something that's a little less interesting. Of the Snyder Cut, Zack has said that he's probably done working on the DCEU, the DC Cinematic Universe, and the writing's sort of on the wall that WB is probably done with that universe as well. And sure, there's a few more movies coming which technically take place in that universe. James Gunn's The Suicide Squad, a Birds of Prey sequel, a Flash solo movie, and Aquaman 2. I don't really know. But it doesn't really matter that all those movies exist within the same universe, because the parts of that universe which act as connective tissue don't really exist without Snyder's movies driving it forward. Having seen Zack Snyder's vision for the universe and hearing what his plans would have been for the future, it's clear that despite being hired to make something like the MCU, he never really had that intention at all. It sort of feels like all the other filmmakers in the DCEU are merely permitted to play with his toys, if that makes sense. I mean, it always sort of felt strange that we were getting a Justice League movie without solo films for half of the people on the team. Marvel took the approach they did with the films leading up to the first Avengers movie because it allowed that story to start without having to bog things down with a ton of exposition. Sure, that might leave some audience members a bit confused if that's their jumping on point, but that's kind of the whole conceit of building a connected universe. A lot of what got cut from Joss Whedon's Justice League, and what makes the Snyder Cut feel more complete in comparison, as well as 2 hours longer, is the same kind of exposition for the characters who didn't get solo movies. The other huge addition to the Snyder Cut is important exposition surrounding the villains and their motives, especially concerning plot elements like the mother boxes and the anti-life equation. Steppenwolf here actually feels like a character. It makes the stakes feel a lot more important, where before it was really unclear what he wanted to do with the boxes, or what a parademon was. Things are a lot clearer in the new cut, as opposed to whatever Batman was doing at the start of the theatrical version.
What the hell?
And I'm not saying a Justice League movie ever needs to be 4 hours long, but you kind of have to set this stuff up somewhere. Which, again, is the strength and fun of doing a connected universe. The MCU rewards investment in previous films when all of the pieces come together. Elements in the Avengers, like the Tesseract from Captain America, or Loki's motivations from Thor, or just broader characterizations of the heroes in general, they're all planted like seeds throughout a handful of films which lead up to the team-up film. Sure, some films are more plot-critical than others in the MCU, especially when you consider characters like the Hulk, but that isn't ever really clear without hindsight. If the MCU has been successful at anything, it's pulling from all corners of its continuity in interesting ways. The story told in the solo films can largely exist on their own, but the good ones always feel like they're at least important to the overall fabric of the universe. When watching the Snyder Cut, however, it's pretty clear that any film that isn't done by Snyder himself isn't really important to the entire DCEU at large. The existence of the Mother Boxes, or the threat of Darkseid, or anything other than Wonder Woman's home of Themyscira isn't really mentioned in other films. Steve Trevor wouldn't be important to Wonder Woman if she didn't mention him every time she was standing next to a plane. And even then, it doesn't really matter that at one point she brought him back to life with a magic wishing rock. Batman shows up in Suicide Squad, but not because he's concerned about that film's world-ending threat or how it could relate to the death of Superman. Instead, he's just doing normal Batman stuff. When Tony Stark appears in films like Captain America: Civil War or Spider-Man: Homecoming, it's at least thematically relevant and consistent with his character's arc at those points in the universe's grander meta-narrative. If you ignore the ending of Iron Man 3, that is.
The clean slate protocol, sir?
Screw it, it's Christmas. Yes. Yes.
Later.
I don't want to hear the man was not meant to meddle medley. I see a suit of armor around the world.
Oh, and don't forget that the Flash also shows up in Suicide Squad for the second time in the universe, actually. But we still haven't really gotten much information about the character other than he's the DC Comics character, the Flash. Something we wouldn't get much of until the movie where all of these characters are supposed to team up. But even then, we don't really know much about him by the end of Justice League. Superman appears in Shazam, but even then that paltry cameo doesn't really feel thematically consistent with the version of Superman that Snyder presents in his films. I mean, you're telling me that this dude... is gonna visit some kid at school? And that he knows Shazam? Shouldn't have those characters meeting been a bit of a bigger moment? Like, it feels like that would be a pretty big, important step for Billy's character development going forward. I feel like I'm losing the plot a bit here, especially as I get more in the weeds on some of these moments, but when looking at what we know Snyder had plans for characters like Superman, Batman, Wonder Woman, and even Shazam, that's where it becomes clear none of this will ever matter. For those who might not know, Zack Snyder's plan for the story of the DCEU looks like this. Man of Steel, Batman v Superman, Justice League, and then two more Justice League films, and that's it. Because by the end of those films, Wonder Woman, Batman, Aquaman, Lois Lang, among others, would all be dead. The world would nearly be destroyed, and Superman specifically would have had this whole arc about becoming Superman. I don't know, it's all sort of unclear. Batman and Lois were gonna have a kid at one point in Zack's vision, and the kid was gonna become Batman after his dad died. There's nothing wrong necessarily with building a story that plays out that way, but it feels disingenuous to pretend like any of that is conducive to a universe built out of the movies we've already gotten. Without Ben Affleck's solo Batman film, or what might have been the original plans for The Flash, we're left with movies that are only about characters which Snyder considers to be ancillary. And even then, it feels a bit moot to be making movies featuring characters whose stories are fated to go in whatever direction Snyder had planned for them in the first place. Now, this isn't the same as, say, the Guardians of the Galaxies having their team upended and changed sort of irreparably by the events of something like Infinity War. Those characters and their stories were necessary to facilitate the stories told in Infinity War and Endgame. Elements like the introduction of Infinity Stones and Gamora and Nebula's relationship to each other and Thanos. Shazam, as far as we know, was never going to be critical to the story that Snyder was telling. He was never going to join the Justice League. Sure, the film introduces the concept of magic, but not really in any substantive way that could have been done somewhere else. Suicide Squad, if anything, potentially set up some villains who might appear later, especially the Joker, but he's really only important to the DCEU's Batman because he killed Robin. Another thread which Snyder admitted he planned to resolve in one of his films.
You know, it's funny. He would talk about people who died in my arms. Because when I held Harley Quinn, and she was bleeding and dying, she begged me. With her last breath, then when I killed you, and make no mistake, I will fucking kill you.
And look, I'm not complaining that the DCEU isn't more like the MCU in terms of telling its larger narrative, but what I am saying is that Warner Brothers was really trying to have it both ways. What's sort of interesting is that the DCEU has actually gotten a lot of the connected universe stuff right in the time since the release of Joss Whedon's Justice League. Aquaman's solo film has a lot of development for his character, and actually made substantial changes within the state of the world and its politics, with Arthur returning to Atlantis and claiming the throne. He becomes the Aquaman we all know, but then again, it didn't seem like he was lacking much in terms of skill or ability in Justice League in the first place. Regardless, however, we're right back to the way things were with Wonder Woman 1984, which seems like it would have been a lot more important to a lot more people than just Diana, what with everyone on Earth having their wishes granted for a day, but ultimately it feels like it isn't even canon. She learns to fly in that movie, but doesn't have that ability in films which take place afterwards. And I know that complaint in particular sounds a lot like some ribcage xylophone nonsense.
Boy, I really hope somebody got fired for that blunder.
But I think it's a clear example of how everyone is just sort of doing their own thing at the periphery of Zack Snyder's epic narrative. Which would otherwise be fine. I would actually prefer if filmmakers working within the superhero space weren't so beholden to continuity and could pull in characters they wanted and reference stories they love without having to worry about how that would affect other films. I mean, DC has actually had more success with that approach in the past than trying to ape Marvel's cinematic universe concept. Christopher Nolan's Batman trilogy is great because it's his take on those characters and that world. You don't have to worry about how Christian Bale's Batman would do in a fight against Steppenwolf or Darkseid because it would be completely nonsensical for those characters to show up in that story. I mean, even a character like Two-Face kind of rides the line between plausibility and outlandishness a bit too hard in that universe. I did not like Man of Steel, and I think Batman v Superman is very bad. But the Snyder Cut works better than the theatrical release because it's a thematic and narratively cohesive continuation of Zack Snyder's vision, for better and worse in some cases.
I will fucking kill you.
And Warner Brothers must understand how this can pay off on some level. They've gone forward with projects like Todd Phillips' The Joker and Matt Reeves' The Batman, both of which don't take place in the shared universe. The former, however, was nominated for Best Picture, and the latter looks like it'll be fantastic as well. I mean, you can't tell me that you're interested in James Gunn's The Suicide Squad because you're excited to see how it fits in with the rest of the DCEU. That movie looks like fun because Warner Brothers gave James Gunn a blank check and told him to make whatever movie he wanted. Considering how that film is related to the other Suicide Squad is really only going to lead to confusion, and honestly, it'll probably be a better time if we just don't think about it at all. And despite my opinions on Wonder Woman 1984 as a film, Patty Jenkins clearly has a passion for the character and telling stories within her world. A passion which she has made expressly clear she does not have for any other characters in the DC universe. But maybe her Wonder Woman stories could be more interesting or dynamic if she was allowed to have Superman show up and not worry about whether or not he was alive or dead or whatever. She wouldn't need to write a story which takes place in the 1980s when it has no real thematic reason to, other than the universe necessitating it doesn't take place anywhere near the time that Bruce Wayne would be operating as Batman. I like the MCU. I am a fan of it. I mean, look at me. I am clearly their target demographic. But I'm also a fan of good movies, which are reflections of a specific filmmaker's worldview or artistic tendencies, and there's nothing saying that superhero films can't be that.
He didn't chase him away.
No.
Even though he yelled at him, I was always mean. And he stole batteries he didn't need.
Well, of course not.
Aside from the companies who own the superheroes, of course. But I think people would like them a whole lot more if they were. There's probably a relatively sizable untapped market of people out there who would be more inclined to watch a superhero movie if they knew it wasn't being weighed down by decade of continuity baggage. Also, maybe if it didn't always devolve into like a mess of punching and giant sky lasers by the third act, but that's an entirely different critique video on its own. We've reached the point where audiences are far more accepting of outlandish ideas and obscure characters. Adapting comic books doesn't have to be done with conceits. Long gone are the days of having to put the X-Men in black leather outfits because dressing them in something more accurate to the source material would be too goofy. The reaction to the Snyder Cut has been relatively good, at least far better than what's come before it, and I think it just further proves that DC and Warner Brothers could have something really special in their hands if they didn't try to be so hard like Marvel. The fans who fought so hard to release the Snyder Cut didn't do it because they were passionate about the future of Warner Brothers' cinematic DC universe. They did it because they wanted to see an artist realize their vision. And it might sound a little silly or pretentious considering we're talking about Zack Snyder and his 4-hour movie where Batman fights bugs from space. I know I feel silly just saying it, but that's the truth. Something has always felt a little off about the DCEU. I could never put my finger on it, but it always felt like a bunch of puzzle pieces which didn't fit together pretending like they did. and that the picture they made up was something that it wasn't. And what I took away from the Snyder Cut is that this analogy is way more apt than I previously thought. The truth is that Warner Brothers hired Zack Snyder to do a very specific job, and he didn't do it. But he did do something different. I enjoyed the Snyder Cut, and while I can't in good conscience recommend any 4-hour movie to anyone, let alone one which is full of moments like this, and this,
you dreamed about me. Were you here when I was forced out?
And this,
dozens of witnesses all over Gotham. Description matches the suspect in the Metropolis abductions.
Wow.
And
I'm your best friend. Besides, who's gonna give you a reach around?
Okay, you get it. It's just that there's so many.
I will fucking kill you.
While I probably can't recommend a 4-hour movie where things like that are all meant to be taken seriously, in those moments I was at least impressed by the self-indulgent audacity of it all, and I think therein lies the lesson which DC could probably take from all of this. Rather than trying to fill a space which is already crowded, they should instead be looking for ways to give fans something which they aren't already getting. And for better or worse, that's what the Snyder Cut does.